Hey everybody, it's Dr. Fresh. Welcome to the BRSFresh Laboratories, where we are going to be doing testing to help you find out the information you need for your setup. And today, we're testing aquarium stones. We are going to put six different stones into the tanks behind me, and we're going to find out what they do to the water parameters so that you have all the information you need to know what's best for your setup. Let's get started. So we sent away off of the base water itself an ICP-OES test. Now check this out, that stands for Inductively Coupled Plasma Optical Emission Spectrometry. Now, that analyzes all inorganic matter in the water. This is gonna tell us absolutely everything as far as how these rocks affect the water. So, our baseline RO water that we put in this tank, we got that sent away and tested. We're then gonna test the parameters like GH, KH, and pH with our NT Labs test over the next couple of weeks. Then we're going to send away another ICP test. It's going to give us all of the water parameters. We're going to find out what has changed incrementally along the way. And from the very beginning to the very end, nothing's going to be left out. Let's take a look at our rocks. All right, it's been 4 weeks and the test results are in. And I gotta tell you, some of these were surprising and I can't wait to go through them. But first, we gotta start with our baseline. So as a reminder, we use reverse osmosis water. And that reverse osmosis water had a pH of 6.5. That is gonna be our baseline comparison to the effects of the rocks. Now, we're gonna go through the rocks one at a time and let you know not only what we found out with pH, KH, and GH, but what the ICP test came back with as far as metals and other elements in the water. Let's go. All right, so know where you're going, you gotta know where you started, and we're right here with our RO water that went into every one of these aquariums. This RO water started with a pH of 6.5, so keep that in mind as we go across all of these rocks. Really undetectable amounts of GH and KH, as you would expect, and basically nothing on metals or trace elements, with the exception of silicon. Silicon came back at 259 micrograms per liter. Keep in mind how small that actually is. It is 0.000001 grams per liter, and it does not affect pH, KH, or GH. It does, however, sometimes affect diatom algae in aquariums if it is present in the form of silicate, but even then, it would have to be in amounts of 3 to 5 milligrams per liter. Right here, we have 0.259 milligrams per liter. So really a non-issue whatsoever as far as the aquarium is concerned or anything that you would need to be concerned about. And lastly, when it comes to heavy metals, absolutely zero across the board. Let's check out the rocks. All right, our first rock here is lava stone. And you know, lava stone is often thought about as completely inert. In other words, it's not gonna have any effects on your water parameters. And that's not exactly what we saw with this particular lava stone. And I think there might be a few reasons why, but let's talk about the numbers first. Number one, when it comes to pH, we started at 6.5 with our reverse osmosis water. By week two, the pH had risen 0.4 to 6.9, and by week four, the pH had gotten to 7.4. Totally acceptable levels of pH in a freshwater aquarium, but not what you would think with lava stone. Why did that happen? Well, I think this particular style of lava stone has little calcium deposits in here. We also have some dust down here at the bottom from not rinsing the stone, and those things combined definitely could have, and it looks like they did, have an effect on pH. But again, nothing to worry about, just interesting because you wouldn't have necessarily thought that with just lava stone. When it comes to GH and KH, relatively small changes. Actually, across the 4 week period, only a 0.2 degree difference on both of them, rising to 1.9 on the GH and 1.4 on the KH. Again, think about it this way. These are just stones that we put in an aquarium with nothing else. So it's not a real setting. And you probably know that GH and KH should be around 7 degrees, right? In a normal aquarium. But that's with all the other variables. You've got fish, you've got plants, you've got substrate. just looking at the rocks effects on the water here, we're just taking a look at smaller numbers. And so that explains why the numbers are smaller than what you might see in a normal aquarium. Okay, now let's get into the ICP test results. And you know, a few things came back here that I thought were interesting. Number one, you saw a little bit of calcium in the water. Now that went from 0 to 1 milligram per liter. Not very much, but again, you'd expect some calcium out of this with those calcium deposits that you can see in the rock. Other than that, nothing outstanding on the ICP test. We'll put a graph on the screen so you can see what some of the numbers were, but all extremely low parameters. Okay, our next rock is redwood petrified stone. When it comes to the big three, pH rose by 0.1 after 2 weeks. Hardly any change in the aquarium whatsoever. It did come up to 7, so a 0.5 change from our starting position by week 4. But again, nothing alarming there. When it comes to GH, absolutely zero change after 2 weeks. So it rose to 1.9 and then stayed at 1.9 after 4 weeks. KH went from 2 to 2.24 after from 2 weeks to 4 weeks. So again, hardly any changes there, hardly any effects to the water parameters. Let's take a look at the ICP test results. Same as lava with the macro elements, just a little bit of calcium, 1 milligram per liter on that. As far as the rest of the metals are concerned and the other groups here, nothing alarming whatsoever. A little bit higher on the silicon, but nowhere near anything to be concerned about. Okay, for rock number three, we've got the famous Seiryu stone, which is obviously one of the most popular stones in aquascaping. And it is a stone that is known to raise pH and have some effects on water parameters. Obviously nothing to worry about because it's very safe for aquariums because everybody has it. But let's talk about exactly what happened with this stone. So by week 2, the pH had gone up to 6.9. To be honest, I actually thought it would have gone up faster than that, but it went up to 6.9. We had a little bit of acidic water, so that was allowing this calcium in the rock to leach out, causing that pH to rise. But by week 4, it was up to 7.6. That's a little bit more like where I would expect it to end up. So a decent rise in pH with the Seiryu stone, as you'd expect. With GH, by week 2, it was at 3.4, and it stayed there by week 4, no change. And KH was at 2.5 degrees KH by week 2, and that went up half a point to 3 or 3.08 to be exact by week 4. So those are the changes on the big three. Let's take a look at our ICP test on Seiryu stone. And for Seiryu, the macro elements, the big one that showed up that you would expect was calcium. Much more so than any other stone here on the list. Calcium ended up at 10 milligrams per liter. Now, again, nothing to worry about, and this is one of the elements that you want to have in your water, like calcium, magnesium. It's good for fish, it's good for their bone structure, it's good for their health. But if you ever want to counteract some of the effect of the Seiryu stone calcium leaching into the water, adding CO2 will bring some of that pH down by introducing carbonic acid. You can also put driftwood into the aquarium. Tannins will naturally counteract that rise in pH and lower it a little bit as well. Nothing alarming here and nothing basically unexpected with Seiryu stone. Those are the numbers. Okay, for rock four, it's the famous dragon stone. If anything is more famous than Seiryu stone, this is it. But this one totally surprised me. I mean, I had not heard that dragon stone doesn't really affect water parameters, but when I got these numbers back, I found out that dragon stone almost has zero effect on your water. Take a look at this. pH 6.5, starting point, right? Guess where pH was at week 2? Still 6.5. By week 4, 6.6, barely changed at all. GH went to 1.1, and by week 4, still 1.1. KH, 0.6 to 0.6, week 2 to week 4. Barely any effect whatsoever on the water, and the ICP test actually supported that as well. When it comes to the macro elements, we're talking zeros. Unbelievable, not even any calcium or anything like that. Literally nothing. One thing that stood out was manganese. Manganese came out at 33 micrograms per liter. Now, dragonstone is made up of iron oxide and other minerals like manganese. Now, why did the manganese in particular leach out? Well, I think it has a lot to do with the fact that this stone is so porous. It's a lot of surface area that that water can get into. And I think that that had to do with why it was able to leach out that metal versus, you know, anything else that we've seen so far. Again, as I come across the rest of these metals, nutrient groups, no changes whatsoever. And once again, we're at 5 micrograms per liter on copper, which is nothing to worry about. So Dragonstone, a rock that literally does nothing. All right, with Elephant Skin Stone, I expected some effect on water parameters, and it delivered. Let's take a look at the numbers. With pH, we started at 6.5 with the RO. By week 2, 7.1 with Elephant Skin Stone. A little bit higher by week 4, ending at 7.5. With GH, a little bit, 1.7 after 2 weeks, but by week 4, it was up to 3.07. KH, 0.8 at week 2. By week 4, 3.36. So you'd expect some of that to happen with a sedimentary stone like this that is going to leach some of those types of deposits into the water. And we saw that with the macro elements on the ICP test on Elephant Skin Stone, notably sodium. Sodium at 7 milligrams per liter was in the water after 4 weeks. Again, this is a sedimentary rock with evaporite deposits. You'd expect some of those to start leaching into the water. Calcium at 5 milligrams, magnesium at 2 milligrams, potassium at 1 milligram. So a little bit more of those macro elements showing up in the water with Elephant Skin Stone than what we've seen previously. And then when it comes to the other elements on the ICP test, nothing really alarming, nothing that really stands out any differently than any of the other rocks. Of course, we saw the silicon come back, but not even as high as some of the previous rocks. But one thing that did seem interesting to me is that this one did not leach any copper as far as the heavy metals are concerned. So as much as it was putting some other things into water, the one thing that these other stones were putting in the water, this one did not. All right, Riverstone. You know, we did not expect to see any changes in the water parameters with Riverstone, and it delivered. No changes on pH across the entire 4 weeks. The only rock, double check my data, the only one to not change pH across the whole 4 weeks. GH, 1.8 after 2 weeks, did not change after 4. 2.2 on the KH after 2 weeks, 2.29 after 4. So really not much going on with the water here. Let's take a look at the ICP test results. A little bit more action in the macro elements, but just trace amounts of milligram per liter of calcium, 1 milligram per liter of potassium. Not much going on in the metal groups. Slightly lower on the silicon than anything else that we've seen outside of the starting point on the water. I think this was the lowest one. So nothing significant there at 305 micrograms per liter. And again, the copper came back at 5 micrograms per liter with this rock. Elephant Skin Stone, the only one out of the entire test to not throw a little tiny trace element of copper into the water. All right, we examined these rocks over a 4 week period, and here is my diagnosis. These rocks are safe for your aquarium. Come on. You knew that from the beginning, right? I mean, these are some of the most famous rocks in aquascaping, but what we wanted to figure out was, what are they going to do to water parameters in relation to each other, right? So keep in mind, when you listen to some of these numbers, it doesn't mean if you put one of these rocks in your aquarium that the aquarium parameters are going to jump by these numbers. This is just a way to understand, of all of these rocks, which ones have different effects on different water parameters. So we wanted to have some fun doing this, have a good time, but also learn something along the way, which I hope you did. And if so, make sure you subscribe to the channel so you can see more videos like this. And in the comments, let me know what else you'd like to hear from Dr. Fresh. We'll see you next time.